people who watch this channel, of which over 100 of you nuts have subscribed at the time of writing this, thank you very much, by the way. It should be no secret that I, the Mega Fan Man, love the Mega Man series. From 1987 to 2018, the Blue Bomber has graced our televisions and various monitors with game after game depicting his fight for everlasting peace against the sinister and petty Dr. Wily. In between my responsibilities of schoolwork, volunteer work, and just plain old work, I've had a blast recording and rambling through some of my most consistently played games on my PC, Nintendo Switch, various DSs, PS3, PS4, GameCube, Wii U, I assume anyway, considering that I, like most of the world, never had a Wii U, and all the rest of them. I intend for this to be a short capstone of the franchise that I've dedicated this little non-monetized corner of YouTube to, closing the book on Mega Man, as it were, and what this channel has been about thus far, at least until the inevitable Mega Man 12 comes out at some point down the line. While I do intend on someday going through classic Mega Man sequel series, Mega Man X, and then onwards to Zero and ZX and beyond, it's not exactly what I want to do next. I'm hoping to branch out to different franchises and fun one-off games that I like and that don't all necessarily involve jumping and shooting to beat up an old man and his goofy drone squad. Now, in order to close the book, as it were, I feel I need to cover the bits and pieces of classic era Mega Man that I simply couldn't through the traditional means of regular old Let's Plays. These bits and pieces include 18 Capcom spin-offs that star our favorite Blue Bomber. Spin-offs in this case being games that are called Mega Man / Rockman something or something Mega Man / Rockman with a few exceptions here and there. This means that I won't be getting into his appearances in the latest Smash Bros. Games, his appearances in the Marvel vs. Capcom franchise as a whole, the Mega Man Upon a Star OVA, his role in the show Captain N, the Game Master, the Archie Comics series and crossovers, various manga, weird Ruby Spears cartoon that came out in the 80s, 90s era, the other weird cartoon that came out recently in 2018, the Dreamwave comics, the Manhua, or Chinese comics, the compilation packages / collection, / ports, canceled projects, RIP, Mega Man Universe, projects and titles that are announced after this video is made and posted, obviously, can't talk about those because they don't even exist yet, so why would I even talk about them? And a few other random titles that I simply didn't find enough about. You know, an example being the Minesweeper clone, Rockman Bugsweeper. I mean, what could I possibly talk about with that? It's Minesweeper, but with Mega Man. I mean, that's it. Additionally, I'll bring up and discuss 6 Capcom-licensed Mega Man games, developed by game studios across the globe. I'll wrap by discussing Mega Man's impact on the fan game creation community as a whole. So yeah, 24 plus titles to discuss. I'm hoping this video essay will be relatively short, though it probably won't be the case. With a franchise and pillar of gaming like Mega Man, with a mascot who did and can stand shoulder to shoulder with some of the other gaming icon greats of the past and hopefully future, there's no way this is gonna be short, no matter how much I may want that. Appropriate though, one last ultra blowout to complete the first leg of my very long-winded YouTube journey. As a franchise, Mega Man has meant a lot to me. And while the road has certainly started to smooth for the Blue Bot shortly prior and following the release of Mega Man 11, it wasn't always a sure thing that this series would ever meaningfully continue. Keiji Inafune's Capcom departure, the Mighty No. 9 fiasco that Inafune and his company, Level 5 Concept, founded in December of 2010, are still struggling to get out from under the shadow of, to say nothing for the other games developed by this studio, and all the cancelled Mega Man projects in between, the series felt like it had hit a dead end after Mega Man 9 and Mega Man 10. A relic of an earlier era with no way to carve a place for itself in the future, unlike other mascots of the past like Crash Bandicoot and Spyro the Dragon. And while it's true no main entries came out during the 8 years between numbered games 10 and 11, or the approximately 10 years between Mega Man and Base and Mega Man 9, it would be false to declare that classic era Mega Man wasn't still pumping out games. As I'll show, the Blue Bomber has had his metallic hands in practically every kind of pie you'd expect a gaming titan like it to have. Mega Man was never really dead and will likely never really die. At this point, it's gotten too large and too many people are aware of him to just let that happen now. It just had a longer hiatus than most before it was able to get back into the swing of things. It's not the only major gaming mascot to go through something like this, as we all know. Prior to Inafune's resignation from Capcom in 2010, Mega Man as a franchise was basically firing on all cylinders. You wouldn't know it simply looking at my channel and the classic era Mega Man content that it is currently filled to the brim with, though. The majority of the games that were being developed and published were Mega Man games for the various other series that encompass the larger franchise. X series games, Zero series games, Star Force series games, CX series games. These were some of the series that were adding to Mega Man's robust library of main entries and notable spin-offs. Capping off with the official return of the original Blue Bomber in numbered entries 9 and 10, though, as we'll discuss, there have been quite a few Mega Man classic era games before these two notable ones. Side note, as for the other series' main entries, I won't be covering those in this video aside from the mention some of them got just now, and maybe I'll bring them up a couple of times later on, but that's it. I will, of course, one day dedicate Let's Plays to most of them, as many other channels have done. One day. Now, following Inafune's resignation, well, I mean, the obvious correlation of lack of Inafune and lack of mainline Mega Man content is obvious to even the most non-observant of Mega Man fans. Whether or not you like Inafune, there's no doubt the effect that he had on pumping out games in the franchise. Anyway, I'm not planning on giving you a big, overly detailed retrospective. You know, better YouTubers than me will or most likely have already provided very detailed analysis and retrospective on this and many other wonderful franchises. I'm really just planning on filling in the holes on a well-trodden path most watching this are familiar with already. You all know Mega Man. I mean, that's why you're here. You all also likely know that he's been out of the spotlight for a while, until recently. Today, I'm going to basically be your virtual Mega Man history curator, showing you gaming's most heroic robot and the spin-offs you likely know absolutely nothing about. So if you enjoy my dry baritone even a little bit, I ask you now to sit back and relax, because we are about to have one last word-filled and fueled Mega Man bonanza.
There's no way you'll ever get into that plasma plant!
It's worth noting before we actually jump into our first game that this channel and many others have already covered a few of the more notable Mega Man spin-off games. These include the 1991 to 1994 Mega Man for Game Boy or Rockman World series, the 1998 interactive movie game Super Adventure Rockman for PlayStation and Sega Saturn, the 1995 and 1996 arcade fighters directly starring Mega Man and his specific franchise cast, these being the Power Battle and the Power Fighters respectively, as opposed to other fighting games that only feature Mega Man or some version of him as a franchise representative among various other franchise representatives, as is the case in Super Smash Bros. Or Marvel vs. Capcom. Remakes such as 2006's Powered Up for PSP, 2002's Mega Man and Bass for GBA, the original Super Famicom release in 1988 in and of itself a spin-off, the 1999 sequel to said spin-off for WonderSwan, and 1994's The Wily Wars for Genesis. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, these spin-offs will not be discussed in this video, apart from their mention just now. If you want to see gameplay and perhaps even my general ramblings on them, I suggest you check them out on my or any channel that has these games available. Apropos to that, these are Mega Man spin-offs I absolutely recommend you play for yourself if you've not already done so. The majority of them embody and carry, to a certain extent, the fundamentals of classic-era Mega Man within their mechanics and presentation. Hell, you can even headcanon most of these into the Mega Man story if you care about that sort of thing. No, instead, I'm going to discuss games that I will never let's play for this channel. Reasons for which vary. For example, I simply have no way of recording the footage myself. Or there isn't enough gameplay to justify a Let's Play video, or a one-off of any sort. Or I simply just don't play the genre of game that a particular spin-off happens to be. It's why I instead dedicate this video to these bits and bobs, these little lost pieces of a larger Mega Man legacy that have likely not been experienced by many of you firsthand, and I myself only have limited exposure to, really. If you're looking for a specific game that you want to hear me go on about, please check the description below for time links. Description also catalogs all articles, videos, and Mega Man wiki pages that I went through to make this video possible. Special thank you to everyone who put in the work first. This video would never have been made without the foundations you all helped make. Special shoutouts to the Mechanical Maniacs, Rockman Corner, Moby Games. I use these sites a lot in particular, but every link to every video and site, their creators have my heartfelt thanks, and I recommend you check them all out if you can. I'm not getting paid for this video or these shoutouts. I'm just a fan, and frankly, if you're watching this, you're probably one too, so why not check these out? These games will be presented to you in chronological order of initial release, with very limited exceptions. I will make note of them as they become relevant. This first batch of 18 were, as far as I'm aware, developed and licensed by Capcom themselves. So, without further ado, the first game to discuss in these, let's call them shallow dives, awaits. Sit back and enjoy. We're about to go on a ride. Wily and Wright's Rockboard, Mega Man Monopoly, released exclusively in Japan on January 15, 1993 for the Famicom system. Though there were plans to bring Mega Board to America, this was dropped. There were even talks of adding the game as an unlockable in the Mega Man Legacy Collection, but this too was dropped. Designed by Yoshinori Takanaka, who at this point had designed Mega Mans 3 and 4 in 1990 and 1991 respectively, and was jointly working designing Mega Man X, which would release later this particular year, Yoshinori's additionally worked as an advisor for Mega Man 5 in 1992, and would go on to be a producer for Mega Man X4 in 1997, Mega Man 8 Anniversary Edition in 1996, would direct another Mega Man spin-off game in 2004, this being Mega Man X Command Mission, and received special thanks in 2002's Mega Man and Bass, and 2003's Mega Man X7. Burn to the ground! Burn! Burn! Burn to the ground! Burn! Burn to the ground! Burn! Burn to the ground! Burn to the ground! Additional credits for Yoshinori are found in the link below. Moving on, Rockboard's art was done by Keiji Inafune. I don't think I need to talk about who he is, for better and for worse, with music composed by Yuki Iwai. Regarding Mega Man, she has additional music credits for Mega Man X, X2, and the Power Fighters. Iwai's other credits are found in the link below. By the year 1993, Mega Man had cemented itself as a gaming staple. Riding high from its first five numbered entries, which, despite some complaints leveled against them at the time for lack of innovation, each entry was able to meet overall positive critical reception due to the products coming out largely the same in regards to quality. You knew what you were getting with a Mega Man game. As such, Capcom was in a position to make the Blue Bomber a leading mascot. And what's a leading mascot without spin-offs? In 1993, two such spin-offs were set for release. One of these would go on to become a mega success that would launch a brand new sequel series that, in some cases, would outperform certain later entries of the classic series, champion an evolution to the overall series formula with a 16-bit coat of paint, and set the tone for the franchise moving forward for years to come. And the other one was Monopoly. Monopoly was certainly a weird choice for a first spin-off game. Most other franchises generally dip their toes into kart racers or sports games, even puzzle games, but no. Monopoly for a console that was already on the way to being replaced. The Super Famicom had already been out for a few years by this point. and Capcom and the Mega Man series would eventually fully transition over, but not before it managed to get off one last main entry, that being Mega Man 6, and this Monopoly adventure. Okay, so getting into the game itself, the first thing that Japanese and now English-speaking players, there's a link to the translation patch and ROM below, not that I condone that kind of thing, it's purely for research purposes, but, you know, whatever you do with it is up to you. Anyway, what you'll notice is Mega Man is not a playable character in this Mega Man game. In fact, now would be a good time to mention that Rock Board is not a game named something Mega Man or Mega Man something. One of the stipulations I set for myself in regards to the kind of spin-offs that I would cover for this video. However, because in every other way that matters, this is an official Mega Man spin-off game developed by Capcom, Blue Boy's even on the cover, I'm gonna talk about it. That all being said, while Mega Man himself is not a playable character, he is the MC and thus technically all over this game. No, instead our playable characters include Drs. Light, Wily, and Cossack from Mega Man 4, Roll, and Kalinka Cossack, also from Mega Man 4. The first time in the series that any of these characters are playable, which is kinda cool considering Rock ain't here to play this time. Now, while my exposure to this game is limited, I am happy to report that, based on feedback from various sites and reviews, links below, this game is actually reported as pretty good and I quote, nowhere near as terrible as a Mega Man board game should be. As you're seeing on screen right now, that all comes down to the Mario Party-esque, fast-paced nature of the experience. Not something you would expect to hear in relation to the word Monopoly, but it seems to be the case here. Matches typically last anywhere from 60 to 90 minutes, with win conditions unique to the mode and board you play, the game ending as soon as a character meets those requirements. Characters spin a roulette and move 1 to 8 spaces. You can buy slash improve property, rent property on spaces owned by other players for smaller payouts from the unfortunates who land on said space, collect cards that hurt or help you, and even temporarily transform into robot masters that disable your ability to buy or improve property but let you mess with the other player's properties in unique fashion. Additionally, there are various types of spaces that can spice up play. You have the obvious E-Tank space, the equivalent is the Monopoly Go space, you pass that to get some money. Card spaces, including Reggae cards that hinder players, this game actually being the Wily support bot's very first official appearance in the series. Anyway, other spaces include construction spaces, they're jail, but with less of a penalty. You only have to wait one turn instead of three, but they are more plentiful around the board and you're not allowed to just visit. Of course, there are land spaces to purchase property, as you'd expect, unique rush spaces which can teleport you to other parts of the board, lottery spaces that let you bet your money for potential big payouts, and entertainment spaces. These let you and other players bet on various Metuel races, again, for potential big payouts and potential big opponent screw-overs. Important to note, character-owned property spaces have rare, unique bonus effects besides making the unfortunate passers-by pay a sum to the space's owner and renter. From having to pay extra money to getting to spin the roulette and move again, the nature of the characters informs what kind of good bonus or bad bonus their properties may invoke when you land on them. Boards included are Green Continent, Cold Island, the continent of Sand, and Megalopolis. There is an ending to the game despite absolutely no story to contextualize what the hell you're doing here, available only to players who win Battle Royale mode and Megalopolis board with 75% or more of the board's available property under their control. The Blue Bomber himself makes an appearance. He's only one in person. Overall, this is a strange first spin-off entry for such an iconic property, though not an unsuccessful one. Ultimately. We'll be right back. next up is a game I considered doing a one-off video on. Mega Man's Soccer. This game was produced by Takuro Fujiwara. Regarding Mega Man, Professor F, as Mr. Fujiwara is sometimes credited, was also the producer for Mega Man's 2 through 7, the entire Mega Man for Game Boy series, and Mega Man X through X3. Outside of Mega Man, you can see his very impressive credits in the links below. Art was done by Keiji Inafune, music and sound design by Mega Man newcomers Oka, or Toshio Okamoto, Tomi, Kenichi Tomizawa, and Noririn, or Norihiko Togashi. This was the first classic-era Mega Man game released for the Super Nintendo. Released on March 25th, 1994, it predated the release of Mega Man 7 for SNES on September of that same year. The game was originally released in Japan on February 17th, 1994. Okay, so we're about a year removed from Mega Man Monopoly now, on to more, dare I say, normal spin-off territory, with the franchise's first foray into the sports genre. The game does have a plot, taking place sometime between Mega Man's 4 and 5, also sometime before Mega Man 3 for Game Boy. The Light family are at home, watching a game of soccer, when familiar, restored robots begin to storm soccer fields all over the world and ruin all the games! This is the work of Dr. Wily, and in response, Dr. Light does the thing you'd expect him to do. Arm his metallic son with the skills necessary to outsport the Wily bots and put an end to the Mad Doctor's plan to destroy the real game of football. Sorry, America, but it's the real game of football. It's the way it is. The game, as it was released, features no ending to the setup I just described. However, using a cheat device, a Game Genie, players can view what I guess was supposed to be the intended endings of the game. There are actually two, and are tied with two of the four game modes offered. Speaking of, let's run through the game modes. There's Exhibition, which is straightforward enough. Players choose their team members and what positions they are in, what field they want to play in, and then they just go and have a game of football, or soccer, whatever, however you want to call it, I don't care. Capcom Championship. This is the main story mode that continues the narrative established in the opening cutscene. Mega Man must face off against 8 Robot Master teams. Each team is one particular Robot Master cloned many times over to cover every possible position in the field, in any order that the player chooses. Beating a team will allow that robot to join Mega Man's team, as Mega Man's also been gifted the power of cloning himself, specifically to cover every position listed in the beginning, and add their own unique abilities and stats that players will be free to experiment with. Beating the 8 teams and recruiting the 8 bots allows Mega Man to take on Anchor from the Game Boy game Dr. Wily's Revenge, canonically the only Game Boy Mega Man game to have happened as of yet, thus Anchor is the only Mega Man killer robot to appear here. Then you fight Proto Man, and finally you take on Wily himself, who has also cloned himself for the purposes of playing a sport, and not to, you know, say, amass 8 different sets of 8 robots with 8 different castles and war machines to take over the planet. Nope, he just used his incredible technology of cloning to just play soccer. I don't know, it's just playing soccer, whatever, it's fine, it's soccer, who cares? Anyway, calm now. Beating this mode unlocks Anchor and Proto Man, but not Dr. Wily, for Exhibition mode. It also unlocks their respective fields, all 3 of them. The code for the game as it stands, even with the genie, does not allow for Dr. Wily to be playable. Though he was supposed to. You can check the link below. For Christ's sakes, he was on. Anyway, here is the intended ending that you would have gotten for beating Wily had the code for the game been fully implemented and completed as it was supposed to be. Here's one of the 2 endings. Moving on, let's talk about Tournament Mode, which is similar to Championship Mode. You can pick between Mega Man and the 8 Robot Masters and compete in a main tournament against 7 other characters. You can't pick the members of your team, aside with who you pick at the start. You get 3 of that character and 5 other set characters. You can check the wiki to find out who specifically you would get depending on which character you pick. If you win, you proceed to the championship tournament against Anchor, Proto Man, and Dr. Wily. Upon beating that, you were intended to view this possible ending for the game. So those are the two main modes in the sense that Championship Mode and Tournament Mode actually have endings to the game. Now let's talk about League Mode, which is another kind of tournament, except you're not knocked out for losing just one match as you would have been in Tournament Mode. Each team at the end of every match is given points. You get more points if you win, but you don't get no points if you lose. And at the very end of the League, whichever team has the most points wins, which is simple enough. League Mode provides you a team. You have no agency in deciding your team apart from who you pick at the start, similar to Tournament Mode. And like in Tournament Mode, you get 3 clones of the character you pick and 5 other set characters. From what I understand, they're not always the same 5 set characters that they would have been in Tournament Mode. You can check the wiki below to find out what characters you would get for picking a Robot Master in League Mode as compared to Tournament Mode. On to the meat and potatoes of the game. Guys and gals, this is soccer. Okay, I don't play soccer. I don't pretend to know anything about soccer. I know people kick the ball, they hit it with their heads sometimes, or their chest. I know goalies are allowed to use their hands, and that's about it. A let's play for me on this, as I had originally intended, would have been more boring than the let's plays I already do. I would have nothing to say or ramble about, and it would have taken forever to collect all the footage I need because, as it turns out, when I tried this, I learned that I suck at soccer games, especially old soccer games. So, for anyone wanting the rules of soccer broken down piece by piece, this is the wrong video for you. The game follows the expected rules, as I think it does, and puts its own aesthetically appropriate twist to engage fans of the franchise. The end. Or, well, not quite. What can I say? If interested, this game, despite not really being finished, is regarded well by gamers overall. The Mega Man aesthetic, the special abilities and unique stats attributed to each character, including stats to resist special shots from other characters, which is not a thing I discussed because, you know, it's soccer. You can guess what the special shots are. They're powerful kicks that can, like, go through people, you know, what you'd expect. Anyway, all these things make the game feel special, comfortable to play, if you're into it, and fun. Yet again, the Mega Man franchise has managed to pump out a strange but successful party game that became a sort of cult hit. To which I say, good for them. Arguably the most well-known, unknown, spin-off game of the classic era that I haven't covered, and the Mega Man answer to the ever-popular Mario Kart, Mega Man Battle and Chase. initially exclusively released in Japan on March 20th, 1997 for the original Sony PlayStation, it would see a release in Europe, the PAL region, a year later. Published not through Capcom, but through then-publisher Infogrames, now Atari SA. North America wouldn't officially get its metallic mitts on the game until January 10th, 2006, when the game was bundled with Mega Man X 1 through 6 and the Mega Man X Collection for PS2 and GameCube. On December 17th, 2014, the game was released on PlayStation Network, but only for Japan. Produced by Keiji Inafune, designed by Masahiro Yasuma, a man with a hand in the Mega Man Battle Network, Star Force, and Legends series, with other credits as well, and Hayato Tsuru, who was a designer on Mega Man Base and Mega Man 10, he was also the director of Mega Man 9 and 10 with additional credits to his name, and composed by Yoshinori Ono, a video game producer and former sound manager with many credits to his name, Battle and Chase being his only Mega Man credit. You can check his and the others' credits in the links below. So now we're a few years removed from Mega Man's soccer adventure, and we've also made the jump away from exclusively releasing on Nintendo hardware. We now enter a world enthralled with extreme robot racing in the form of the hit new live show, Battle and Chase. Now, aside from the thrill of the game, winners are rewarded with tons of cash. Right now, it's 10 million zenny. The allure of the race and the reward bring out all manner of robot that want the prize money. For some reason, including Mega Man, who's looking to surprise Dr. Light by getting the necessary funds to repair a computer recently broken in a thunderstorm. That's right, that's the reason.
Urge to kill rising.
The racers compete, and at the end of the tourney, surprise, surprise, Dr. Wily arrives to just outright steal the cash, and whoever you're playing as must race him. And base most of the time to recover your sweet, sweet reward. It's Mega Man, of course, so there's not much going on in the way of plot, but it's worth noting this is the follow-up to Mega Man 8, before Mega Man and Base released a year later. I mention it because the racer lineup is kinda weak. You have Mega Man, Roll, Proto Man, Bass, Wily, and Duo from the recently released Mega Man 8. They were pushing him in a lot of spin-offs at this point. But then you also have Guts Man, Quick Man, Ice Man, Shadow Man, Napalm Man, and Spring Man. That's the Robot Master representation. And you know, I didn't discuss it much in the Mega Man Soccer segment of the video, but Robot Master representation is important in a Mega Man spin-off. And to a certain extent, I'm fine with the representation in Rock Board and Soccer. Limited hardware capabilities combined with somewhat bizarre premises for action franchise spin-offs result in, you know, weird picks that I think ultimately work. But when it comes to racing, and it may be unfair to compare, but the Mario Kart of the day and the Crash Team Racing of the day were capable of having diverse series representative lineups without having modern day hardware to just shove everyone in. This game would already be a lot better if, aside from the Lightbots and Base, there was at least one Robot Master from each main game. Only 8 characters, that means. They already have 6 Robot Masters in the current lineup. Just replace Iceman with a Mega Man 4 Robot Master, add a Mega Man 6 and 8 Robot Master, and for God's sakes, replace Spring Man with Turbo Man, the Robot Master that actually transforms into a racing vehicle. Alright, but calming down now. Aside from my personal nitpick about the limited lineup, the game's actually very good fun. Capcom worried about competing in America against Mario Kart and CTR when that later released in 1999, resulting in the game's limited exposure here, but I think they should have gone for it. I mean, Battle and Chase features some then very impressive representative visuals close to what CTR would bring to the table, and certainly better than Mario Kart 64. Bringing a traditionally 2D series into 3D with great success, I think. Now, the game's gimmick. Whereas Mario Kart doubled down on items and CTR would double down on its very impressive drift mechanics, Battle and Chase focused on, as the name would imply, battling and chasing. Every stage has hazards, those are to avoid, and enemies, those are to attack. You have to attack them to gain enough points to unlock an item roulette and actually acquire an item. No item boxes here, you have to openly attack enemies to get items. Doubling down on this, every character is equipped with a basic weapon. In Mega Man's case, his Buster, at his side at all times. You hold off on using it though, and it'll charge, allowing for you to better destroy obstacles and mess with the players in front of you. Firing an uncharged shot or spinning out from damage or just from hitting an obstacle or something will cause the charge meter to reset, so there's your trade-off. You want to fire weak shots or you want to save up for major damage, that's up to you. Every character has a unique uncharged power and unique charged special ability. Every character also has their own unique vehicle stats, acceleration, speed, turning, etc. And every one of those unique attributes can be taken from them to power your character up. And therein lies the Mega Man twist to this game. You like Roll's special abilities? Well, if you beat her in a race, you can take it from her for your Springman playthrough to have a unique twist. If you like Protoman's speed and his abilities, you beat him twice to take them. Each successive race more difficult than the last. The game encourages you to carve your own path and create the best you possible. As is Mega Man custom, of course, in the main Grand Prix mode, you are allowed to choose the order of the stages you go to. The cast of characters, their unique attributes and abilities mean that there are dozens of ways to play the campaign of this game. There are 15 courses, most of them are character specific. They encourage replayability to see and experience it all. The mechanics encourage players to master them to have fun. There's tons of little control tidbits and secret content and abilities and racers I won't be talking about for this segment. In short, despite my lineup nitpicks, this game is fucking wonderful and an immediate recommendation in my book, especially for anyone that's a fan of CTR and the remake. Capcom should absolutely try and remaster this game with these mechanics for modern audiences, and it's a crying shame how limited its release is outside of certain territories. This is a true Mega Man experience in a spin-off package. It's great. Definitely check it out. All right, we're going to jump out of chronological order now with our first mobile game on this list, Rockman GP. It's directly based off of Battle and Chase and released for Japanese mobile phones through the now abandoned by Capcom of Japan iMode service, Japan's popular mobile internet service, in 2004. So the only footage for it that I could actually find was the following. Link to the website and YouTube channel located in the description, by the way. The game was created, I think, to capitalize on any popularity that Battle and Chase may have held among the Japanese market for all these years. I don't know. The game only has two modes, a versus mode and a time limit or time trial mode. The game features three racers, Mega Man, Roll, and Bass, again, with unique attributes as in Battle and Chase, and weapons, but no abilities. And there's also at least three tracks. Only two are featured in the found video, the training course taking place in the day, and a city course taking place at sunset or sunrise. But images for Rockman GP on its wiki page suggests that another course, some sort of nighttime course with tighter turns than what you'd find in training or city, is also playable as well. And that's really all I can tell you about this one, ladies and gentlemen. Starting around 2001, 2002, and ending around 2011, 2012, Capcom of Japan were semi-regularly pumping out Mega Man games like GP here for mobile phones in Japan. In fact, with only a few exceptions, the remainder of the games I'll be talking about today come from Capcom of Japan's mobile phone campaign game library. I'll have a lot less to say for each individual game, as each individual game is more or less what you see is what you get. For anyone watching without using the time links below to jump to games you are interested in, now may be the time to try it out. I hope, at least, a picture is being painted as to why I'm not dedicating Let's Plays or even one-offs to games like this, or simply not enough content to justify it, if I could even find a way to play it and make it interesting to boot. At the same time, though, the games are interesting in their own right. Some, like this, for the sheer fact that it exists, and there is some remaining proof that it exists, and that proof must be shared in some form or another, thus, this video. Hope you're all enjoying this so far, because now, we're gonna be doing some rapid fire. Here we go. Believe it or not, I've actually already played a version of Rockman Battle and Fighters on the channel previously. If you want to check them out, they're called Mega Man The Power Battle and Mega Man 2 The Power Fighters, the two Mega Man for arcade fighting games that are released originally in 1995 and 1996 respectively. I did long plays on both of them, and they basically cover everything you'll find in Battle and Fighters, except it looks better because arcades are more powerful than the Neo Geo Pocket. Anyway, Battle and Fighters released for the Neo Geo Pocket Color on July 6th, 2000, exclusively in Japan. I didn't do a video on this for the reason that I had no idea this existed. Had I known sooner that Battle and Fighters was a thing, I probably would have included it at some point after finishing the Power Fighters long play. As it stands, though, Battle and Fighters is great. They're the same games as the arcade originals, only graphically toned down. It's a true port, not some third-party remake. All the usual gameplay mechanics, all the music, still sounding good on the Neo Geo, even if it is limited in the number of tracks. All the cutscenes, all the powers, all the characters, all the abilities, the movement, the pace, it's all retained as best as it possibly could from the arcade originals. The game even goes so far as to include a bit of content not in the arcade versions. Character bios for the 18 bosses, the 7 playable characters, and more, for a total of 43 Mega Man character bios, with 2 bios that appear in both Power Battle and Power Fighters for the reason that 2 characters reappear in Power Battle and Power Fighters. I'd go on about this one for a while, but I've already talked at length about Power Battle and Power Fighters before. And while it may be shameless, I'm gonna plug my own work again, ladies and gents, and recommend you check out those long plays for all the rambling information your minds can possibly take. For now, understand that this game is great because those games were great. You're getting an accurate representation of the arcade originals from this port, and that's easily the highest praise I can give the Neo Geo Pocket Color Battle and Fighters. This is absolutely one you should check out online. I believe English patches have since been made, if you can. Jump, Rockman! Released for Japanese mobile phones in 2001, this appears to be an endless platformer where you, Mega Man, are tasked with dodging obstacles and jumping, but not shooting, to higher platforms to eventually meet up and rescue Roll. I think the game kind of misses the mark a bit, and not for the obvious reasons. The game implies romantic connection between Rock and Roll, and you know, if you're into that, that's cool, that's fine, I guess, but they are brother and sister, and I'm not a fan of the version where that's thrown out the window. In fact, that's a small gripe I have with Mega Man Powered Up, but that's a different conversation for a different day, for all the good things that game does. Anyway, the gameplay itself, for the time, for the hardware, actually looks pretty good. I kind of wish there was sound, but you know, odds were you were playing games on a Nokia phone on the bus or the subway or in the office, at school, and other general environments where the sound wouldn't be appreciated. So, you know, I get it. Not really something to Let's Play or make a one-off video on, though, but as it stands, it doesn't look too bad, all things considering. You can even try it for yourselves if interested. Check out the links below.
Okay.
Capcom of Japan released Rockman Panic Fire for mobile phones in 2003. Ladies and gentlemen, you ever play Bomberman or any Bomberman game? Because this is like that. Mega Man has found himself in a strange situation. Trapped in the mad Dr. Wily's castle, the Blue Bomber has to escape the clutches of... I guess Fireman? Randomly? It's Fireman. It's DLWN007 from the first game. That's the big bad for this mini-adventure. Anyway, Mega Man has to escape the castle with no weapons, all while avoiding Fireman's white-hot wrath. The key words to take away are no weapons. Unlike Bomberman, Mega Man has no access to his own fire weaponry, or bombs, or a buster, or anything of the like. The gameplay is just defensive movement. I mean, even Jump Rockman, which we covered previously, had the element of verticality to its advantage. And I have no idea if this is any good or not. I have found almost no evidence that this game even exists. I did find some images, though, and from them, I can establish that there's Changekees, the flame enemies, or tackle fires, and bombs that lie around the stages, as well as a ladder that I suppose is the exit of the stage. Fireman seems set to appear periodically to launch fire that may leave behind the tackle fires and set off bombs in a manner similar to Bomberman. It's also possible that, like in the main series, the tackle fires may move around. I don't know. Maybe. If nothing else, I can confirm that this is an interesting concept. It's at least less transparent than Rockman Bugsweeper. I mean, that game was absolutely nothing to differentiate itself from Minesweeper, aside from some Mega Man assets being dumped here and there, based on the few images that exist for this title. And while it's obvious that this early 2000s era of classic Mega Man was an era of Capcom milking its metallic blue cash cow dry, at least some projects, like Panic Fire, attempt to do something interesting with the assets available to them and attempt to establish twists on gameplay mechanics that already exist in other IP. And that, if nothing else, deserves a lukewarm pat on the back. Pat, pat. Good job, I guess. Ladies and gentlemen, also in the year 2003, Capcom of Japan released Rockman Slot for mobile phones. It's a slot machine, guys and gals, and unlike slot games for phones today, there was no loot boxes or special rewards or anything besides what the base game itself carried. And what the base game itself carried was Mega Man 1, the slot version. And Mega Man 1, the slot version, is not enough to keep people's interest for long, at least today. Games of this nature can be updated, basically have infinite levels, additional modes. At the time this came out, the only thing that kept this fresh for any period of time was the random nature of the slot machine. And I guess people's boredom. You can pick from any of the six robot masters. Presumably you go up against Wily when all is said and done, just like in the original game, and are then dumped to a slot machine. You see, the premise is Wily combined the bots with slots to create slot bots. The boss slot bot requires you, the blue bot.
For to me, there is nothing the least bit funny about stealing a meal from Neil McBeal, the Navy SEAL.
To collect a certain amount of credits before the stage is considered complete. You can bet up to 5 credits, you start with 20. On rows and diagonals, and if you match or get certain patterns, you win and get credits added to your score. You don't get any of that, or hit a big eyes, and those credits remain subtracted from your total. If your total hits 0, you lose. The game features the original soundtrack, fitted for phones. It doesn't sound half bad, but this game, well, it's barely a game. It's closer to Rockman Bugsweeper than Panic Fire on the scale of how hard that Capcom tried to make this feel more unique than it really is. The answer, if you skip to this game, is they didn't try very hard at all. This is bare bones, ladies and gentlemen. Is it any wonder I didn't play these games? ladies and gentlemen, I just want to make a note of something. The next 10 titles that I'm going to discuss were recorded in one session, my fourth recording session for this video, and I was actually slightly sick for that. So if my voice sounds a little different for this next bit, these next, I'm going to say 10 to 20 minutes, that's why. So apologies in advance. Hopefully it doesn't get in the way of the video. That's it. That's all I wanted to say. Moving on. Released on mobile phones for Japan in 2003 alongside the previous two titles discussed, our next game is Mega Man Space Rescue. Titled as such because it would get a North American release in 2006 as a digital download for your phone. The game was apparently received well enough to get a reskinned re-release later that same year in the form of Mega Man Rocket Christmas. Again, that title comes from the fact that the original Space Rescue and Rocket Christmas were both released in America 3 years after the original Japanese release. In Space Rescue, Mega Man has volunteered himself to save astronauts. The Blue Bomber is equipped with a jetpack to traverse and explore the wonders of space as he searches for astronauts stranded throughout. It's up to you to navigate Mega through asteroids, wormholes, and more using your jets and inertia. In Rocket Christmas, Rock takes it upon himself to dress as Santa Claus and deliver presents to all the good children of the Earth. In both titles, the mechanics are pretty simple to wrap your mind around. Mega Man's only course of action is to fly in any direction across an endlessly looping stage of a certain size. Each stage has obstacles, objectives, and an exit. Obstacles vary, though all are designed to make you waste your limited fuel. You lose when you run out. Objectives are consistent in every stage. Save the astronauts slash deliver the gifts. Exits are locked gates located somewhere in the stage. When your objectives are complete, you need to make your way to the now open exit point. Make sure you have enough fuel to get there or you will lose. The model of Mega Man in both titles doesn't look half bad. The game doesn't sound half bad either, so it might be worth a look for you. Don't forget to check the links below to see if you can download some of these lost Mega Man games and try them for yourself. Ladies and gentlemen, a year removed from the blitz of mobile phone Mega Man titles released in 2003, we now have Mega Man Pinball, released in 2004 on mobile phones in Japan via the previously brought up iMode subscription gaming service that Japanese mobile phone users use and has since been abandoned as a viable platform for Mega Man titles by Capcom of Japan. The game would also be released 2 years later in January of 2006 in Europe. As the title implies, it's Mega Man and Pinball, and that's it, enough said. It's specifically modeled after Mega Man 2 and has four stages, Bubble Man, Air Man, Quick Man, and Dr. Wily, who is in Crash Man's stage for some reason. Each stage comprises of a two-screen pinball setup. The first screen has a boss door with a Lightning Lord robot protecting it. Destroying it allows access to the second screen where the robot master actually is, hidden by additional doors. You destroy the doors, destroy the bot, you win. You start a stage with a certain number of balls, which are the equivalent of lives. You lose those, and it's over. That's it. Not much more to say. The game seems fine to play. Sounds good, but it's just pinball. And if just pinball is enough for you, then check it out. Could be worth your time. Okay, now I really have nothing more to say. It's just pinball. So, yeah. The end. Moving on. Following Capcom's 2003-2004 mobile phone Mega Man game Blitz, the company took a step back for a few years, only to strike back hard in 2007 with a legitimately good title. Rockman Tennis. Released for mobile phones via the iMode service, Rockman Tennis is Mega Man's next sports game. And like the racing and soccer/football from before, this is, again, pretty good. The game features 7 characters from the first 3 Mega Man titles and 1 surprise character. We have Rock, Roll, Blues, and a bunch of boss bots, 1 from each game. Take notes, Battle and Chase. We have Cutman, Woodman, and Shadowman. The surprise character is X from the Mega Man X series. X is playable after completing, well, we'll get to that, but he's in the game, and that's pretty cool. So, the game features 4 cups to compete in. The Light Cup, which is easy mode. It features a series of single set matches for anyone not in the know on the rules of scoring in tennis. This isn't the video for you, suffice to say. Single set matches are the shortest types of matches. It's played on the green court. Then we have the Kozak Cup, which is medium mode, featuring best of 3 sets matches in the wild court. Then we have the Wily Cup, which is hard mode, which features a best of 5 sets matches on the asphalt court. And finally, the EX Cup, which is extra hard mode, only unlocked after completing the other 3 cups, and again, features the best of 5 sets. Now on the EX court, completing this cup unlocks X. Each character has their own stats and a super move, with X being the secret character, having the best stats and super move. Super moves can be used when the character's meter gauge is full. The gauge fills a little bit with every hit of the ball and fills a lot by collecting weapon energy tanks that appear on the court randomly. The game also has screws. As per usual with games that have screws, you can spend them at auto shop in between matches for parts to help in games. You can equip up to 2 at once. Finally, the game also features 4 modes. League Battle, Free Battle, which is just custom matches, a shop, and the options. The shop, again, as we discussed, you buy parts to equip for the games, and that's it, yeah. Each character has their own theme when playing against them. The game looks great for phones, it sounds great. Honestly, this seems like a game that should have had some sort of console release a few years earlier when that was still a focus for Capcom with Classic Era Mega Man. As it stands, I can't really imagine it controls 100% great on a phone, at least not compared to the far simpler games that were coming out the years prior. This, without having the ability to play it, seems to be a case of too much ambition. A full tennis game on your phone as opposed to endless flying, jumping, pinball, and the like. That's a baseless gripe, though. I can't really say anything too negative about a product that looks really surprisingly good for the year and platform it came out on. I truly hope to see this game in some form or another in the future. Intuition, Rockman. The Blue Bomber's first minigame collection. Released January 7th, 2008 in Japan for D904i mobile phones via the iMode internet service once again. One look at this and you'll immediately see that this was at least partially inspired by the criminally underrated Mega Man Powered Up, which is always a good thing. So, it seems that this time around, the Mad Doc Wily has completed some sort of brand new machine that will at last let him take over the planet. Whoa. Mega Man manages to find Wily pretty quickly this time, but is unable to stop him so long as he is actually in the machine. Wily destroys his own hideout trying to kill the Blue Bomber and fails. He then resorts to kidnapping Roll when Rock tries manhandling the machine. While shaking the machine a second time, a series of games fall out. It thus seems obvious that to save his sister, Mega is going to have to play these games and upload his scores as he competes for the best score in the country, I guess. Anyway, beating the games destroys the machine, saves Roll, stops Wily, blah blah blah, you know, at the end. It's pretty admirable they put any story at all into this, so, you know, kudos for the effort. The games themselves, there are 12 in total, pit Mega Man against the 6 Robot Masters from Mega Man 1 for 1 game each, taking on Metz and Sniper Joes for another 2 games. The copy robot from Mega Man 1 makes a return for one of the minigames. You cook with Roll, randomly, even though she's kidnapped, for another one of the games. And finally, you take on Dr. Wily for the last 2 minigames. There's a healthy variety of simple, polished, phone-friendly minigames in this collection. You have rhythm minigames, FPS minigames, racing minigames, and more. If you're somehow able to find this, you'll probably get a kick out of at least some of the minigames found here. It looks good. Wish I could play it, even for a little bit? Check out the specifics in the link below, as usual. Now we have a title released exclusively in America, finally. On December 7th, 2009 for mobile phones, it's Mega Man Rush Marine. The Blue Bomber is back to his side-scrolling shooter origins here as Wily and his forces take to the seabed across various locales to drill for oil, damaging the islands and local wildlife around them. Mega and his trusty robo-dog Rush take to the seas to put a stop to Wily once again. It's nice to get another classic-era game released in the US. It's fine. There's really nothing bad about the title, just not much to it. Nor should there be. This is a phone game after all. You're moved right, it's an auto-scroller, either on Rush Marine or Rush Jet, contrary to the name, you're not just in the ocean. And all you need to do is move around the provided space, shoot the things you want dead, and navigate through the paths so you don't get crushed by walls. You have a health bar, a heat gauge to control your shot output through Rush, you take on Wily and his various bots, and call it a day. A simple Mega Man adventure for simple hardware. Nothing exceptional, nothing terrible. This game, from my impressions, is just fine. And there's really nothing wrong with that. And now, moving swiftly away from the US mobile phone underwater Mega Man adventure, we jump back to one final blitz of officially developed mobile phone games for the Blue Bomber's classic era from Capcom of Japan. First up, and likely the shortest segment today, is Rockman Diver, Japan's mobile phone Mega Man adventure. Released in Japan January of 2011, Rockman Diver is an endless runner of sorts. Mega Man dives, and it's up to you to maneuver him out of the way of spikes. You do that until you die. That's it. I found no footage of this, just an archived site which is linked below, and of course, the Mega Man wiki page on it. It's interesting this was released on Docomo, AU, and SoftBank branded mobile phones for about 380 or 315 yen per month through the Capcom Party service. Yet another attempt to move their mobile online services with the help of ROC. But that's really all I got here. As usual, if you have anything additional to share, especially footage, comment below. Okay, moving on to something a little meatier now, we have Rockman the Puzzle Battle. Released July 1st, 2011, the game is available for Docomo, AU, and SoftBank branded mobile phones, like Diver earlier the same year, in Japan. The game is still apparently available for download via Capcom's digital download servers and, as usual, the iMote internet service for Docomo brand phones according to the Mega Man wiki page. Ladies and gentlemen, we have yet another recreation of the 1987 original, which the game's thumbnail and title screen are clearly invoking. Mega Man is up against the original six boss bots, as well as Yellow Devil, Copy Robot, and the Mad Doctor himself. No sewer defense bot this time, though. Instead of jumping, shooting, and special weapon into victory like before, though, you take on your foes with spheres. That's right. It ain't called the puzzle battle for nothing. Mega Man and the boss of the stage take turns with the board, selecting a sphere and moving it in the directions available to swap it with another sphere and try to match up a number of spheres of a single color. Doing this allows you or the Robot Master to attack the other for varying degrees of damage. Aligning four spheres or more of a single color allows for an extra turn for whoever aligned those spheres. There are E-tanks that can sometimes pop up on the board. You can collect these and use them when running low on health, as per usual. Enemies can collect and use E-tanks as well. Anything you can do in this game, your enemies can do as well. You win when you deplete a boss's health to nothing, and you lose when a boss does that to you. As you know, go figure. This game looks like good fun, and seems, from my impressions, to be one of the better mobile phone games in regard to execution of concept, simplicity of concept, considering limited hardware, and polish. This includes aesthetic, audio, and otherwise, of the final product. I wish I had easy access to it, and if you have the ability to try this out, I think you should. Rockman's Pixel Art Logic, released on mobile phones in Japan on September 1st, 2011. And that's about all I know for this one, yours. Aside from a couple of sentences on the Mega Man wiki page for this, this game may as well not exist. If you want to learn a little bit about the game of Picross, or Nanograms as this is sometimes referred to as, which is the genre of game that this apparently is, check out the links below. Otherwise, is it really no wonder that there's no one-offs of this game absolutely anywhere on the internet? And I use game pretty liberally with pretty big quotations around it. I mean, come on. I don't know what this is. Nobody knows what this is. This is just a thing that maybe existed. Who knows? I don't know. Whatever. Let's move on. Let's move on to something that we actually know existed. Let's get away from this. Let's go. Ladies and gentlemen, we have now reached the end of this section of the video. 16 of the 18 games covered in some form or another. I decided to cover the last two together, Rockman Solitaire and Rockman Poker. Solitaire released January of 2012, and Poker released February 29th, 2012, both for mobile phones. These are both card games. The only mega thing about them is the fact that some Mega Man characters are present in some form or another. If you know Solitaire and you know Poker, then you know what you're getting into here. If you're able to find these, anyway. I'll tell you now, if it weren't for the fact that Mega Man 11 just came out, this would be quite the whimper to go out on. And I'll have more to say in the closing section of the video on Mega Man as a whole, but man oh man, did Capcom ever milk this poor bot dry during their multi-year mobile phone campaign. Thankfully, as we'll get into soon, fans and other companies in general will take their love and adoration for the franchise and keep breathing life into a series that almost breathed its last with Solitaire and Poker. We're also going to talk of other companies that, well, they tried their best.
It's intermission time.
Ladies and gentlemen, there is no sugarcoating this. In this next section, we are gonna get really, really weird. Weirder than Mega Man playing poker. Weirder than Robot Masters playing tennis. Weirder than machines saving Christmas. Weirder than a trio of genius scientists, a robot girl, and a flesh and blood actual little girl playing Monopoly with another robot in the background acting as an MC to the proceedings. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we are getting weirder than piles of scrap metal and quirky programming and their teams of clones playing actual real-life soccer. Unlike a great deal of the games from the previous section, it's more likely, I think, that you may actually be aware of a few of the titles we're about to go over now, for better or for worse. Some of these titles hold a special place, to me, in the history of our favorite blue bot. In the history of publishers and their relationships with fan projects based off of their successful works, in the history of gaming as an art form, these next few titles hold a special place indeed. Now, it should come as no shock to you, but many franchises license out their mascots to other companies. And, well, these are the adventures of the Blue Bomber when he's temporarily out of the hands of Capcom. And they are, well, they are something else. ladies and gentlemen, when it comes to the video game industry, it's helpful to think of the 80s and 90s as the video game Wild West. There were no established rules that people should follow when making a game. No one really knew how to tell a good game from a bad one, aside from, does this feel like a good game? Like a fun game? And certainly, no one knew who among the many, many, many developers out there were actually putting forth the effort and the time to make solid products guaranteed to last, and, you know, who wasn't doing that, necessarily. As a result, this was an experimental time. People with skills, dreams, and determination trying anything and everything to make something that would stick with people, to create an experience that would stand out in what was quickly becoming a very crowded field. And of course, to make money. Tons of it. Quick. And to use it to either get out of there before the burgeoning industry gets to work on establishing rules and guidelines to weed out shovelware, a term used to colloquially describe, you know, shit games nowadays. Separating those from the games seriously contending for your time and money. Or, alternatively, they could use that money to grow and evolve alongside an industry uniquely primed to grow and evolve very quickly. Companies like Nintendo and Capcom, they wanted to build a foundation to grow and evolve as best they could. Companies like High Tech Expressions and Rosner Labs, they did too. Kinda. I don't know. Ladies and gentlemen, this tale that I'm about to tell you is really strange and indicative of the Wild West era of gaming. I mean, there's no better way to say this. Are you ready?
Are you ready, kids?
Because we're about to learn a little bit about a man named Steven Rosner. And to properly talk about this man and the quote-unquote game that he made, we're also going to have to talk about a company named Riggs International. Responsible for the Commodore 64 port of Street Fighter and the game Pocket Rockets, developed by Riggs International, a company that made a grand total of, I think, one game in its heyday, this game, Pocket Rockets. Riggs International, which consisted of three employees, including Rosner, an artist, and the boss, again, the developer of one game, maybe two, see the links below, was bought by Capcom USA to be used as an internal development studio, similar to how companies like Naughty Dog and Santa Monica are used by Sony today. For reasons I haven't been able to find, that never happened. The company was bought, certainly, but never actually used. Not to say the people weren't given work to do, Rosner in particular. See, Capcom USA left Rosner in charge of overseeing external developers, and I guess that means he was in charge of maybe overseeing the other two employees of the now-acquired Riggs, the artist and the boss, as mentioned earlier, and maybe bringing in other people. I don't know. Accounts of the tale are not clear on that. I think it's because Capcom themselves weren't clear on that. Anyway, Rosner, a fan of the Mega Man series, can't fault him for that, decided to move forward with making his own Mega Man game for DOS. I guess to Americanize the brand and get people who somehow didn't have a Nintendo console introduced to the franchise through PC. Anyway, Rosner didn't hire anyone. He didn't work with the artist and the boss from Riggs. He just started work by himself, answering to no one. Never a good thing in such a fundamentally collaborative enterprise. Then, Rosner leaves Capcom USA, and they let him take his in-development Mega Man game with him. They give him permission to publish his DOS game when completed, and that's it. No stipulations, no guidelines, no nothing. Free rein to go carte blanche with an established franchise. I mean, permission to do what, okay. Imagine if Corey Barlog left Santa Monica Studios today and Santa Monica and Sony just let Corey complete and publish his solo-crafted Kratos 8-bit platformer? Yeah, that sounds really fucking awesome. But it would absolutely never happen today. And the fact that this was allowed with Mega Man? Truly, it seems like sometimes Capcom had no idea what a success they were sitting on, Capcom of USA at least. Or maybe they just trusted this guy that made maybe two games with yet another of their big franchises. Either way, that's a yikes. Moving on though, Rosner founds the company, Rosner Labs, and now, not at Capcom USA, had no access to assets or codes from the actual Mega Man games. This kind of sharing wouldn't happen until Rosner Labs was brought on to port Mega Man X to PC. And even then, the sharing wasn't intentional. Rosner Labs had to play the game to manually reverse engineer the code. So anyway, Rosner just made the whole game from the bottom up, from scratch. And you can tell. The fan game made somehow official through sheer dumb luck. And odd decision making by a company that maybe you should have already known better was released in the USA in 1990. Officially listed as developed by High Tech Expressions in association with Rosner Labs, the game is listed as published by High Tech Expressions and designed exclusively by Steven Rosner. High Tech Expressions was an American game publisher that went defunct in 1997. Their list of published games are located in a link below. The game, I don't really know how the hell to describe it. It's loosely Mega Man-esque. According to the wiki page, I guess Rosner came up with a little plot to tie this all together. There's a supercomputer made by the government. It's called the CROCQ, or Croc, I guess, that Dr. Wily moves in and reprograms, and this computer goes ahead and makes all the robots of the world go nuts. Three of these robots, Sonic Man, Volt Man, and Dynaman, guard keys to Croc in Wily's lair, and Mega Man has to swoop in, beat the bots, get the keys, stop the computer, and then stop Wily after that. This is generally regarded as one of the worst PC games of all time, and yeah, you can see it. Clear as day. I don't know what to tell you. On a technical level, this is actually pretty well optimized. It can run at high frame rates, has pretty good scrolling, but Rosner never locked in a speed for the initial release, so the game always runs too fast. There's a patch if you're actually interested in playing this as intended or at all. Overall though, ladies and gentlemen, this game sucks. And it's a prime example of the fast and loose nature of the video game industry and its standards during the Wild West era of gaming. But do you know something? I'd be willing to laugh off this musicless, off-looking, funhouse mirror image experience of Mega Man if there wasn't a goddamn second one that we're gonna have to talk about right now. Released in the USA in 1992, 2 long years after Rosner's first quote-unquote masterpiece, was the sequel for Mega Man for DOS. Mega Man 2, Mega Man 3, The Robots Are Revolting. Again developed by High Tech Expressions in association with Rosner Labs, again published by High Tech Expressions, again designed only by Steven Rosner, this time with some help from his brother William, listed as an artist. Steven is also listed as composer for the game. That, from what I saw, doesn't have a soundtrack, but I might be wrong about that, I don't know. Initially developed as a different game, Echo Man, where a hazmat-suited character explores non-linear stages on an oil rig and ship, High Tech told the Rosners they would only publish their work if it was reskinned as a Mega Man game. And Capcom, who went along with this again, specifically told High Tech that this game will be Mega Man 3 instead of 2 because Sparkman, on the box art of Mega Man 3 for USA, kind of looked like one of the Rosner-designed robot masters. I don't even know where to begin. In the previous section, I was covering more of the backstory of these bizarre games' creation. So I guess I'll just talk about the games themselves this time. Mega Man for DOS and Mega Man 3 play largely the same, which is to say badly. The two floppy disk games are rough, and I mean very rough approximations to what Mega Man is and how it's played. Everything looks just a little bit off. Mega Man's too round, the backgrounds are flat, and sometimes clash very hard with Mega Man, making it hard to see. There's no music, only sound effects. As mentioned in the previous section, game speed was never locked, meaning things move too fast. You get hurt so quick, enemies gang up so often with such little breathing room. Most who play this never see a single boss, let alone the ending. The few stages in the games can potentially be skipped in their entirety. Special weapons are there, but not overly useful. There's no difficulty curve. Things are either impossible or mind-bendingly easy. They're both very short games, not as a result of skill, but overall lack of content and bugs. The wrong graphics card makes the game look like this. And overall, they just feel off and look off and are off. The games really feel like they were made by just one person, and you know, they basically were. But you can feel it as you watch or as you play. They're just bad. And I really don't like saying that because I believe Rosner when he says he's a fan of Mega Man, and I really do think he put in the effort to get his fan project made official a reality, but it's just bad all around, and there's no other way to put it. The Robots Are Revolting now features a cast of 6 original Master Bots to take on, upped from the 3 of the first go-round. They are Wave Man, with a sprite ripped from Air Man and would loosely inspire Mega Man 5's actual Wave Man. Torch Man, looking like Magnet Man and later on in loosely inspiring Fireman.exe in the Battle Network series. Shark Man, ripped from Crash Man and Snake Man, and perhaps it also loosely inspired Sharkman.exe later down the road in the Battle Network series. I don't really know. I mean, at least the name. Oil Man, ripped from Flash Man, inspiring the powered up Master Bot. Blade Man, ripped from Metal Man, inspiring Mega Man 10's Blade Man again, loosely. And Bit Man, ripped from Hard Man and Spark Man. He's the reason this game is Mega Man 3 and not 2. Bit Man is the one that looks like Spark Man, and Capcom wanted to use the US Mega Man 3 box art for the game, which depicts Spark Man. You also take on the supercomputer Croc again at the end, as it's responsible for making the bots evil. Again. You also take on Wily again at the end, I think. I don't know. I really didn't look at much of this game before doing this. I really didn't want to. It's hard to look at this without getting a headache. Both of these PC games feature the same ending. The credits to both are slightly different. That's it. It's a bad time all around, ladies and gentlemen, but not entirely without some merit. As I mentioned earlier, certain Master Bots would eventually, loosely, and only partially, inspire good official counterparts in the franchise down the road. The swimming mechanics in Mega Man 3 would actually return for realsies in Mega Man 8, and Mega Man's inability to shoot through walls would come back to stay from Mega Man X5 onward. So strange to think that bits and pieces of some of the official Mega Man projects have their inception traced back to Steven Rosner and his quote-unquote masterpieces. Now, as much as Capcom would happily like to keep moving forward like these games never existed, they did. They had an impact. Both some good stuff and a lot of bad stuff. As much as I could dedicate the rest of this video to just bashing these DOS games more, I recognize that passion and effort was put into these projects, regardless of the final outcome of said projects, of which they are a frustrating mess. Steven Rosner, did you know, is still actually a game developer to this day? You can check out his credits in the link below. And that deserves a lot of respect. He clearly has a passion for creation and gaming that should be celebrated. A drive that refuses to cool, even after 2 back-to-back failures. So, on that note, let me shut up and just give Steven Rosner's bizarre interpretation of Mega Man a moment of respectful silence, with no music, just like the games. Okay, moment's over. Let's move on to something that's actually better now. Years removed from the Rosner era, Capcom again tried to license the Mega Man property to an outside source to expose the Blue Bomber to other non-Nintendo consoles. This time, thankfully, the situation is a lot more normal than handing over utilization of the brand to, you know, some guy. The keys to the Blue Bombing Cash Mobile were now given to Freestyle Software Limited. You can see a little of what they're all about in the links below. I couldn't really find much. They went incorporated November 11th, 1992, and were involved in a few projects outside the Mega Man for Game Gear game we're going to discuss right now. The game was published by US Gold Limited, an 80s and 90s era video game publisher that was bought out in 1996 by Eidos Interactive, publisher of Batman Arkham Asylum, Small World. You can see more of US Gold and Eidos in the links below, and released exclusively in the US for the Sega Game Gear in 1994. Simply titled Mega Man, this Game Gear exclusive loosely retells the start of Mega Man's battle to stop the vile machinations of the sinister Dr. Wily and establish everlasting peace for humans and robots. And loosely is the key word here. The game takes various elements from Mega Man's 4 and 5 and a little bit from 2 to create a mishmash approximation of a classic Mega Man adventure for a handheld console. The game looks good and sounds okay enough. The Game Gear audio gives each familiar theme a different sound. It's not necessarily bad, it's just also not necessarily fantastic or on par with the original NES soundtracks either. But the first problem becomes apparent as soon as you pick any stage. It's the screen size. It's a very similar but slightly more extreme version of the problem that the GBA version of Mega Man Base suffered through. The original game was designed with larger screens in mind, and in an effort to not make sprites look extremely teeny tiny, the screens were zoomed in to give handheld Mega Man players the same visual experience as players who play the same games on their big TVs. The problem with zooming everything in is everything is zoomed in. Enemies you'd normally see a mile away pop up uncomfortably close instead. Simple jumps become leaps of faith. The saving grace here is Freestyle actually gave players the option to manipulate the normally unmovable camera by holding the jump button. This allows you a few moments to move the camera in any direction in order to properly plan jumps and anticipate enemies. There's only four robots to choose from this time. Bright Man for Mega Man 4, Stone Man, Napalm Man, and a Green Star Man for Mega Man 5, all much more aggressive and faster than they were on the NES. After beating them, you move on to Wily's Formidable Fortress to take on Wave Man for Mega Man 5, Toad Man for Mega Man 4, and Wily himself. The game features two difficulties: normal, you take less damage and there are less enemies in stages, and hard. You take more damage and all enemies are in the same exact places slash and the same exact amounts that they were in the NES originals. Unlike the Rosner games, Freestyle's attempts to imitate Mega Man works overall. It's no replacement for the original adventures, of course, but if you're looking for a Mega Man experience that you've likely never tried before, this one might be worth taking a look at least. It's advertised as Mega Man for the hardcore fan, with all of the most challenging stages, tougher bosses than before, and no continues. If that tickles your fancy, look for it in an emulation site near you. Rockman's Gold Empire. Developed by Strawberry Software Softworld International, makers of other Taiwanese exclusive Mega Man content like Rockman IQ Worldwind, Rockman X Mathematics Worldwind, and Rockman Dash. Great adventure to save the world. I won't be covering these because their titles are literally all I know about these games, and it was published by Capcom. This game was released on PC in Taiwan and only in Taiwan in 1999. Like Rockboard, the very first game we took a shallow dive on in this video, Gold Empire is also a digital strategy board game. So, this is an odd one. I won't have much to say about it. There's no footage that I could find.
Liar, liar, plants for hire.
It's pants on fire, Patrick.
Well, you would know, liar.
I found some images in the sites linked below, and descriptors that paint a picture of this being essentially a spiritual sequel to Rockboard, playing very similarly reminiscent rules and space types that are depicted in Rockboard. There's even little events that happen across the board, like they would happen in something like, say, Mario Party. Playable characters this time include the Blue Bomber, which is a difference from Rockboard, Blues, Bass, Duo, and a new character called the Mayor. This guy may actually be familiar. If you read the Mega Man Archie comics, he appears in issue 23 and in the Sonic and Mega Man Worlds Unite storyline as Mayor Leonard Dorado. Unlike in Rockboard, where Mega Man was the unplayable character, this time around, Dr. Wily is the unplayable character. He's always controlled by an AI, and your objective, no matter who you are, is to beat him and the others in the board you're at. You do this by collecting gold and building up strong properties to withstand Dr. Wily's attacks. Visuals are displayed in 3D 45 degree bevel mode. In addition, there's also supposed to be role-playing elements, but I can't really tell you too much about them because I don't really know too much about them. Characters, again, all have unique attributes. What they are, I can't say, except for the fact that they have them. Music is mostly original compositions, and the artwork is a combination of original pieces and images from Mega Man 8. That's really all there is to say for this one. It's another interesting game that I would love to see more of one day, if possible. But for now, it's just not gonna happen. Next up is another Taiwan exclusive Mega Man title, Rockman Strategy. Direct translation of this is actually Rockman War. Developed by Dream Come True and published by Acer TWP, a subsidiary of Acer Inc., a Taiwanese multinational hardware and electronics corporation, this game released on October 29th, 2001, with a re-release, again only in Taiwan, in 2002. So this is the opposite of the previously discussed Gold Empire. This, well, it's quite the unique strategy game experience. I won't discuss it much here, partly because I never had the pleasure of trying it out for myself, and partly to give you all the chance to try it for yourselves, because this really needs to be experienced to be believed. But the game does have an original plot with original villains, and of course Dr. Wily, a combination of new, original bosses, a brand new lineup of alien robots led by Apollo and Luna, known as the Constellation Droids, and returning master bots from the main series games. A true globe-trotting adventure where the fate of the Earth hangs in the balance. This is a true real-time strategy game. Each team, Mega Man and his opponents, has an active time bar that slowly fills. When filled, the team can, you know, start moving around the area and do things in the field, including actually moving, fighting, accessing your menu to save, to load, to see your options, etc., or to end a turn early, which would actually heal your team. How much would depend on how early you ended a turn on your own terms by selecting this option, and not because the active bar drained by itself. You can also leave a stage if you already finished it earlier during your turn, if you want. There are 17 stages with a few events in between the phases of bosses available. Like in some of the Mega Man games, you don't have access to all of the Constellation Droids, all 12 of them, right off the bat. You get access to 4, then an event, which is the mid stage, like the one in Mega Man 7 or 8, then the next 4, etc., 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 until you reach the Constellation leaders Apollo and Luna, after which you take on Dr. Wily himself. Combat is done in a separate screen. You have a total of 30 seconds to give and defend against damage as much as possible in a mock Street Fighter-esque setup. You can use special attacks, these depend on the character you are or going up against. Attack regularly, defend yourself, or just run away from the fight in general. Mega Man no longer takes his opponent's weapons, as every character and enemy in the game is assigned an element. Mega Man is now able to change elements to better combat foes. Dr. Light's lab makes a return from the main games, with screws again being the main currency. You can replay previous stages to farm for screws. Here, as usual, you can purchase items of various usages, equipment for your characters, chips, and permanent stat boosts. You can create partners for the field, original designed robots, all of them with unique attributes, and save your overall progress as well. Gameplay is pseudo 3D. By which I mean that it looks 3D, but isn't actually 3D, with original art in the Mega Man 8 style for cutscenes and Light's lab. It's pretty crazy that this game exists and is as deep as it is. Honestly, I could probably make a full series on this if I had the time, or really play at strategy games like this one. But for what it is, a game with 14 unique Constellation Droids, 27 returning Robot Masters from Mega Man's 1 through 8, an original plot, a new character, the other bot on the title with Mega Man and Rush, that guy's name is Fan. He's a silent bot of good fortune. I say he's an original new character, but he's never really directly addressed, so he's, you know, it's kind of weird. He is a new character, but he isn't really. He's just there for the Taiwanese audience. Like, I don't know. Anyway, a creative use of the brand, usually known for doing one thing. This is definitely worth a look. Because this doesn't do the one thing the brand is usually known for, and, you know, it's pretty unique. And luckily, there are great Let's Plays of it. One of them is in the card above and in the description below. Beware though, from what I've seen, the game, while unique, is not super polished, no? A lot of little errors and glitches here and there build up to be significant issues. But regardless, this is a lost piece of Mega Man that you probably should look into. Nonetheless. Ladies and gentlemen, our final game, Street Fighter X Mega Man. It released on December 17th, 2012. It was developed by Sozong Hu and published by Capcom. Quick side note, I apologize because I'm pretty sure I definitely totally messed that name up. Okay, note over. Back to the video. This is, for all intents and purposes, a fan game. Like the Rosner projects from earlier. The difference, this is actually quite good. Something Capcom was very proud to slap its name on and give away for free, as was the intention of the creator in the first place. The project was in development since 2009, before So approached Capcom USA with what he had thus far in 2012. Capcom, now no longer the same company it was in the 90s, took a look at his work and decided to officially fund, provide input, and officially release the project later that same year. This was all relatively recent and all pretty big news when it happened, so chances are, as compared to everything else, you already know a thing or two about this one. Really, the only reason I didn't play this one for the channel was because I made my choice to commit to only one fan-made Mega Man project indicative of the best that the community is capable of making. And for me, that was Mega Man Unlimited. Not to belittle the achievement of Street Fighter Cross Mega Man, it's obvious that the quality and passion, the care and the love put into this game are nothing short of inspiring, but I'm not going to pretend that I don't have a preference. Compared to Mega Man, many of Capcom's other titles simply don't interest me as much. That said, this title is a wonderful 25th anniversary gift for both Mega Man and Street Fighter as franchises, combining the things really cool about each of them and wrapping them up in a quality Mega Man action platforming package. Now, I want to take a moment, since our final game was conveniently a fan-made project, to talk about the influence Mega Man has had on the gaming community as a whole. There is zero doubt that Mega Man is influential. He's up there with the all-time greats and deserves that spot. Because while Capcom has long since stopped churning their making Mega Man games machine, fans haven't. I can't even begin to list all the amazing efforts that dominate the fan game community. We already touched on Street Fighter X Mega Man. I have a Let's Play on Mega Man Unlimited, the best of them in my opinion, but I'd be remiss if I didn't bring up projects like Megapony, the MLP crossover with Mega Man that I'm sure all fans of the now-ended show can appreciate. Mega Man Super Fighting Robot, for fans of the old cartoon. Mega Man Maker, an actual fan-made Mario Maker game, but for Mega Man stuff. Mega Man 2.5D, and those are just the ones at the tip of the proverbial iceberg. Even the awful DOS games are fan-made projects created with passion and drive after being inspired by the originals. Mega Man is a big deal, and despite a rocky road filled with quality entries and titles people actively try to wipe their minds of, it's proven a massive, long-lasting series that has inspired and will continue to inspire people to join a community that thrives on creativity, drive, initiative, hard work, determination, entrepreneurship, and everything else one needs to be a rounded and successful creative type in the world we live in now. Mega Man inspires game design, and that, in my mind, is the ultimate true success of the Mega Man franchise. It's the success of every entry, even the weird ones, even the sports ones, even the Mario Party-esque ones, even the Monopoly ones, even the whatever this is supposed to be ones. Mega Man brings out creativity and drive in the game design community. That is the ultimate legacy of the classic era and the franchise as a whole. That is the true success of Mega Man. You know, I wrote the beginning and ending to this video essay first. Which, side note from the future, this whole thing turned out to be 44 pages. I mean, what the fuck? I am recording the beginning and end of this video essay first, and all the little bits and bobs in between. I'm mainly doing this in order to get the non-research writing out of the way and save the more intensive research-based writings, which is the meat of this essay, for later, i.e. once I've actually collected all the information I need to intelligently speak of the games you just got finished hearing about. Presumably you didn't just skip to the end. If you did, hi, hello, welcome. That all said, this conclusion isn't just to wrap up my thoughts on the spin-off titles. I probably did that a little earlier as I was discussing them alongside the fan-made projects and the franchise as a whole. I want to wrap up my thoughts on the Mega Man Classic era as a whole, and finally move forward from this multi-year-long side project of mine. I first got into the Mega Man games when I was just beginning high school, maybe just before that. My first exposure was Mega Man 9 on the Wii Virtual Console, and it very quickly became one of my most played games on the Wii. No surprise that I would then proceed to download all the Mega Man games available on the Virtual Console soon after. I remember coming back home from school most days of the week and having a Mega Man session, or sesh. Well, no, session sounds cooler, where I'd play one of the games from start to finish before doing my homework for that afternoon. They were my casual games of choice when I traveled to Chile, for a two-week vacation years and years ago. They were my catalyst in my quest to find and purchase the appropriate cables so I could actually play the games in Chile in the first place. When my Wii cables eventually broke a few years later, they were the reason I needed to immediately go to a Best Buy and buy replacements in person rather than order off Amazon and wait the extra few days. Mega Man games were always immediate purchases for me as soon as they were available on every console I own. I have Mega Man games on every console I own. They are an investment with no downsides in my mind. In short, just in case it wasn't clear already, Mega Man is very important to me. The good and the bad alike, the franchise has become a fundamental pillar in my experiences as a gamer. They are fun, they are action-packed adventures that challenge players to think, to learn, to react from the moment you hit the stage select screen until the moment the credits begin to roll. They incentivize replayability, memorization, bursts of improvisation. The prize of these games is getting so good, you make it look effortless, you make it look cool, you can make it even look epic sometimes. I have loved recording and rambling over some of my absolute, for the most part, favorite games that I've ever played. I won't get into the specifics of what makes Mega Man games so much damn fun. You have access to hours upon hours of edited footage that will show rather than tell. You have access on every current console you likely own to make a worthwhile and cheap purchase or two and see for yourself. In short, come on guys and gals, do I have to break it down? The games speak for themselves by this point. But now it's time to finally close the book. And with the plethora of titles covered both in this video and the channel at large, I feel as if I can finally do just that. So until next time, ladies and gentlemen, where we do something a little different. Bye-bye!